I want to get your initial reaction to that first. I know it's a bit late, but what do you think? Are we in better hands with Senator Ralph Recto at the helm of DOF and with the pronouncements he's made?
If his position is no additional taxes, we are in better hands. Because, you know, we keep saying that we can keep adding new taxes, but we will not, if we will not be able to improve enforcement, literally fund our digitalization, then it will be of no use.
Okay.
Because we will just be burdening those who will be, those who don't have influence, those who cannot go around the law.
All right, so let's talk about specific measures now. I mean, just this year, President Marcos signed the ease of paying taxes measure into law. That was in January. It essentially simplifies the process, allowing individuals to file either electronically or manually.
Anywhere.
Anywhere. What has changed and why does it matter?
To me, Mimi, honestly, it's a welcome development that finally we are able to remove some of the barriers. Like, for instance, now we allow payment anywhere. I mean, it's really more of the problem of the tax administration, because it's hard for them to monitor how much is the collection of per district, per region, if taxpayers will just pay anywhere. But again, they need to be funded so that it will be the system that will allow them to extract that information and not burden us to just pay where they can account the collection per district or per region. So they have a valid reason, but it's not enough to burden us for so long. Second is, we've been hearing about digitalization, but there is really no funding. We always rely on USAID or international grants. So this time, it's already enacted that they're mandated to have this ease of paying taxes or ease of doing business and digitalization roadmap. Therefore, there should be a budget, because they cannot enforce that if it's just an administrative program. The commissioner will just have to find a way within his budget. But this time, since it's enacted, they are mandated, then there should be a budget that will be approved by
and
Congress.
What is the net benefit of the ease of paying taxes measure? Have you crunched the numbers? I mean, how much benefit versus the cost, the additional cost?
Well, to me, honestly, I didn't get any numbers from the government, but to me the net benefit really is more than the number. It's really encouraging more voluntary compliance that hopefully we will see in the coming collections. That number one, even the VAT refund, which is actually good news for our foreign investors, that there will be no blanket rule that every VAT refund application will have to be reviewed, audited, and go through the long process. Now, if you're a low risk, a compliant taxpayer, no need for review. It's like a mutual academic approval of your refund. I think that's the best news for foreign investors. And again, digitalization has been there, but we haven't really felt it that much. And hopefully, with the budget that is awaiting, well, they are forced now, because in the United States, for IRS, U.S. senators and Congress are really very particular with the budget that they have to give to IRS just to make sure it's smoothly implemented. In the Philippines, we just keep passing laws, but we don't really earmark budget. We just let BIR do the magic, which is not fair.
Not fair to the BIR. Even. All right. Other measures pending on the table. I know that this administration wants to continue some of the tax packages that were carried over from the Duterte administration. Package 4, in particular, PIFITA. We call it the PIFITA. It is Passive Income and Financial Intermediaries package. Your thoughts on that?
Well, it's simply standardizing the tax on passive income. And I think it will also encourage Filipinos to actually go into stock market investment or stock investment, given that it also aims to lower the final withholding tax on stock investment. But I think ultimately the digital tax has also been carried over, that they want also to pass the digital tax, which is imposing 12% on those which are earned by foreign tech giants, which are not actually declared here, especially during pandemic. I think Congressman Sal said there was the one who estimated more than $50 billion revenue, but a single peso was not paid to the Philippine government. Mm-hmm. So with the digital taxation, then we can expect collection from Facebook, Amazon, and all these tech giants.
Mm-hmm. So there will be some groups who will pay more, who will start to pay more.
Exactly. Well, technically, it's to level the playing field, because the brick and mortar are paying already.
The CREATE law, you know, I was surprised that for all the good stories you've come out about the CREATE law, lowering corporate income taxes, some of the companies I spoke to said it also created a lot of headaches, which is why you've got Dek Goh himself saying they're looking at tweaking some of the provisions there?
Well, Mimi, I don't know if you remember, but that's one of the contentions during the deliberation of CREATE law. We are empowering DOF and BIR too much. You know, investment promotion should be the DTI's work, not DOF. They are into fiscalize as fiscalizer. So you don't expect them to be very generous to investors. It's DTI's work to attract foreign investors, but we empower them through FIRB or through this CREATE law. So now the main issue is the IRR itself is conflicted because it's inconsistent with the quote-unquote spirit of CREATE law, which is to really give as much incentives, this VAT refund or this VAT zero-rated or VAT exempt. So that's why now in Congress, there's a CREATE more bill because they're trying to fix the problem of CREATE law.
How do you fix it? Because the ones I talked to, at least, they're saying, you know, it's just unfair. They're changing the rules in the middle of the game.
Well,
that's
agree.
Our main beef.
I actually am I was very hopeful when I heard the statement of Secretary Go, which is if we have to consider returning the power to IPAs, to our investment promotion agency. And I agree, Mimi, you know, it's hard to attract our foreign investors. Then when they get here, they will have to deal with a lot of bureaucracy and all. They don't understand that, and they'd rather go to countries where it will be better for them. So it's not just the taxes or the tax rates. It's the total cost of doing business. All these headaches, paying more consultants, paying more, or finding ways to get to the top of, or to the one on top or on power, that's not how foreigners do business. So I guess giving it back to PEZA and to the economic zones will be faster or more efficient because they know their clients, they know what they offered, and they will be able to provide special attention to them because that's the purpose of special
the
economic zones.
One-stop shops.
It was in a way distorted simply because there's a higher authority now telling them, wait, if it's above 1 billion, we did decide on that. And here comes BIR interpreting, oh, you're not excluded, you're excluded. This is the only those who will be exempted. No, give the power to the IPAs. But let the joint oversight committee of both Congress and Senate monitor the IPAs because that was, I think, lacking before. That's why, quote unquote, abuse. But I don't think the abuse issue will be addressed by more bureaucratic processes.
Point taken. You also listed some other tax proposed reforms to simplify tax processes. Let's go over one by one. Adoption of pre-populated tax returns. For those who are not technical, what do you mean?
It's like a credit card billing that every single self-employed or professional will receive a billing from BIR. That their return is already prepared for them and they just either confirm or if Mimi wants a lower tax, then you provide substantiation so that you can pay lower. Otherwise, you could just confirm and pay.
That's even more work for the BIR.
That's exactly the point. The work should be with the BIR, but through digitalization, of course. We don't want to burden them manually. There should be data sharing that even professionals, lawyers, accountants like myself, doctors, will not be able to hide their income or they will be able to match it with their bank accounts. If Mon Abrea's account is increasing, but his declaration is decreasing, then there's a gap that BIR should be able to assess right away and bill it to me. This was actually a study of a Stanford professor. We just used it as a case study in Harvard, and I made it up as a paper and submitted it to the Ways and Means as a proposal.
And where is the proposal now?
It will be discussed because the Ways and Means is very open with all the proposals right now.
All right. And you're also pushing for the implementation of risk-based audits.
Well, I'm very much hopeful because EOPT implemented already or carried already the risk-based VAT refund. So now, I think it's...
This is what you mentioned earlier.
Exactly.
If you're compliant...
No need for audit. Same with regular taxpayers, not just for those applying for VAT refund. If I am compliant, if you're compliant, BIR should have no business with us.
All right. And simplification of tax regimes for MSMEs.
The EOPT has started it.
It sounds like a tall order.
Yeah,
the
EOPT has started it. But again, the threshold may have to be revisited because it's only 20 million. I mean, taxpayers can earn more than 100 million because especially if you're retail or online. So 20 million cap is a bit too low, but the regime means we may have to consider flat tax. Now, there will be no other taxes but 10%, and that's all that micro and small taxpayers should be paying.
Is 10% the number?
Well, the effective rate is below 5%. So 10% is double the effective rate. So I guess that's more than enough, but no burden for taxpayers.
All right. And you want to create a separate office for processing VAT refunds?
It's not that I am that the BIR is hopeless, but I think it's a conflict of their mandate. Their mandate is to collect, not to process VAT refund. So
who should do the processing of
it's still under the OF, but a separate office or center. Ah. Because I think BIR is overworked. That's why they tend to really unintentionally delay things. Because whether you like it or not, they will face the liability if they just approve or release all the VAT mm-hmm. refunds. But if it will be assigned to another office, then there is no conflict of interest that they need to audit.
There's also one more. Tax refund office for tourists. A lot of people who visit, for example, Europe and buy expensive things, they make sure to keep the receipt.
Yes.
Because at the airport, you can actually get X percent back as a tax
exactly.
refund. We don't have that yet.
We don't have that because we don't have the law or the VAT refund mm-hmm. for tourists. But that's also something that we can consider. While some local consumers may react that they won't get the refund, but they know how it benefits. Because like for all of us who travels to travel abroad, we know that it's something that really encourages to ask for
to
a receipt.
Shop, yeah.
To shop, ask for a receipt and claim it either at the airport or right at the store. Like in Japan, I think you can already claim in the same building where you actually made your purchase, as long as you show your passport and your ticket going home that you're actually going back, that you're not staying or a resident of Japan. So I guess that's something that may also be considered.
So aside from these proposals, do you have any other proposals in mind that you think could make this tax regime better for Filipinos and for investors?
Well, number one, for individuals, I think we need to really reconsider that the 35% ultra rich. Nobody's paying that. A lot of our professionals have shifted to one person corporation simply because for corporation the highest rate is 25%, while for individual the highest rate is ultra rich 35%. Who among our legislators are paying 35%? I think nobody's paying 35%. Everyone shifted to the one person corporation, so might as well level the playing field as well mm-hmm. for individual and corporate taxpayers. To me, that rate is very contentious.
All right, and so I imagine these are the conversations you're gonna have
yes.
in the upcoming conference.
Yes.
Tell us more about the conference. What are some of the contentious issues or discussions that you're expecting
to
have?
Really
who are the big personalities attending?
It's really breaking barriers in this digital economy. And it's not just the digital economy like online transactions. We are all part of the digital economy. We have World Bank. We have OECD, who is actually which lead this global minimum tax. Finally, we'll be able to collect taxes from Facebook, Amazon through the global minimum tax because we signed the agreement already for the first time.
What is the global minimum tax? There's a number already.
15%.
15%.
Meaning whether they are registered in Ireland like Facebook, if they're generating 100 million in the Philippines, pay 15% here.
Ah, all right.
So I think that's a fair deal. So breaking barriers in the digital economy, we have international tax experts, global government leaders, and of course, the leaders are in the digital economy. So everyone will be there, not just to talk about theories, but actually to come up with resolutions, action plans, moving forward. How do we exactly benefit from this, and how do we attract more foreign investors, because we don't just espouse ease of doing business, but we continue reforming our tax policies and all these barriers that stop us from earning more money.
All right. On that note, Mon, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for giving us a sneak peek
yes.
at some of the exciting discussions that you're going to have in the conference. We're looking forward to exciting news from that event. Thank you again.
Thank you, Mimi. See you next year.
See you next, hopefully not that long.